grateful to God that he has brought us through another week, another 6 days of toil and labor, of evenings where we could come together and fellowship with each other. This is now our Friday evening worship session, and we have one more exciting topic to discuss, and we hope that you will be enlightened, you will be refreshed, but most of all, that you will feel the blessings of the Sabbath. We will begin with the singing of a few of our Sabbath hymns. We will start with "We Love Thy Sabbath, Lord," hymn number 0. We love thy Sabbath, Lord, and worship at thy will. Oh, may these our sweet peace afford and deeper faith instill. Thine angels stand for joy, creation's work to see. We to this day will raise our hearts in grateful praise to thee. Praise for thy wondrous love that seals this sacred day. A sign that all may understand we own thy sovereign sway. O great Creator King, through thy redeeming grace, renew and sanctify our hearts that we may see thy face. And with the wardrobe throng upon Mount Zion be, and joyful sing our Sabbath song through all eternity. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for another beautiful Sabbath. We love thy Sabbath, Lord, and we worship at thy will. Please continue to be with us as we continue in our worship. We pray in your dear son's name. Amen. Our next hymn is "Safely Through Another Week." God has brought us on our way. Let us now a blessing seek, waiting in his course today. Hymn number 384.
Safely through another week, God has brought us on our way. Let us now a blessing seek, waiting in his course today. Day of all the week the best, emblem of eternal rest. Day of all the week the best, emblem of eternal rest. While we seek supplies of grace through the dear Redeemer's name, show thy reconciling face, take away our sin and shame. From all worldly cares set free, may we rest this day in thee. From all worldly cares set free, may we rest this day in thee. When the morn shall bid us rise, may we feel thy presence there. May thy glory meet our eyes when we in thy house up there. Here afford us, Lord, a taste of our everlasting feast. Here afford us, Lord, a taste of our everlasting feast. May thy gospel's joyful sound conquer sin and comfort saints. May the fruits of grace abound, bring relief to all complaints. Thus may all our must be till we rise to reign with thee. Blessed may all our Sabbaths be till we rise to reign with thee.
Don't forget the Sabbath. The Lord our God hath blessed. Of all the week, the brightest. Of all the week, the best. Hymn number 388.
Don't forget the Sabbath, the Lord our God has blessed. Of all the week, the brightest. Of all the week, the best. It brings repose from labor in times of joy divine. It's beams of light descending with heavenly beauty shine. Welcome, welcome, ever welcome, blessed Sabbath day. Welcome, welcome, ever welcome, blessed Sabbath day. Keep the Sabbath holy and worship him today, who said to his disciples, I am the living way. And follow our Savior here below. You give us a fountain whose streams eternal flow. Welcome, welcome, ever welcome, blessed Sabbath day. Welcome, welcome, ever welcome, blessed Sabbath day. Day of sacred pleasure is golden hours we spend in thankful hymns to Jesus, a children's dearest friend. Oh, gentle, loving Savior, how good and kind thou art. How precious is thy promise to dwell in every heart. Welcome, welcome, ever welcome, blessed Sabbath day. Welcome, welcome, ever welcome, blessed Sabbath day.
Now go into our opening hymn, which is O Day of Rest and Gladness, number 382.
O day of rest and gladness, O day of joy and light, O balm of care and sadness, most beautiful, most bright. O thee the high and lowly, who bear before thy throne, sing holy, holy, holy to the eternal one. The wise ports protected from storms that round us rise, a garden intersected with streams of paradise. The wise cooling fountain fill us dry, dreary sand. From thee, like Pisgah's mountain, we view our promised land. A day of sweet reflection, thou art a day of love, a day to raise affection from earth to things above. New grace is ever gaining from this our day of rest. We sing the rest remaining in mansions of the blessed.
Dear kind and compassionate Father, we thank you for another day. We thank you for another Sabbath. We thank you for taking us safely through another week. As we welcome the Sabbath, or as the Sabbath is already here, as we get into our service this evening, please help that everyone here will be blessed by it, and please help that we all may be able to enjoy the Sabbath in your courts, in your name I pray. Amen. Thank you.
just joining in our worship, we thank you for coming out and happy Sabbath. You're being reminded that the link for the quiz is open, so you may go right ahead and do that, as it will be closed right before our presenter begins her presentation. So, we've been having wonderful week so far, haven't we? We have learned so much, and it is at this time that we sit and we reflect on the goodness of our God. We began our week on Sunday evening. Our elder, Elder Garth Wright, presented under the caption, Our Spiritual Addiction. And he expounded and he explained to us on Sunday evening what an addiction is and that we need to be spiritually addicted. On Monday evening, Dr. Beryl Irons spoke to us on your child and COVID-19, a worldview. And I'm sure maybe some of the things that she said we heard before and some things that were said we didn't know about. So we were really enlightened on how this pandemic is and has been affecting our children. On Tuesday, Sister Josine Marshall Baker told us about different types of addiction in children. And I dare say some of our parents and adults alike may have a few of these addictions as well. I'm sure we learned quite a bit from Sister Baker as well. On Wednesday evening for our prayer and praise session, we had a prayer for the children and we listened to our own Pastor Beckford as he expounded on the importance of prayer. And we were able to share with each other the benefits of prayer by giving our testimonies. Just last evening, we heard from another spirited person in the form of Sister Mrs. Charmaine Edwards from the Ministry of Health, who spoke to us about the dietary needs of not just the children, but our moms whilst pregnant, and how the eating patterns affect the children. And I'm sure we found out a few things that we never knew were not true. And the mothers amongst us can relate to that one myth, that one thing that we all thought our lives that was true. We found out just last night that it really wasn't so. And this evening, we're going to be talking about communion, the meaning of communion. What is communion? The symbols around communion. Why communion? Should we commune? You'll be learning all of these things this evening. Now, we will not be doing our usual announcements of winners this evening. However, we invite you all to be present at the end of our services tomorrow evening, where all the winners will be announced from Sunday right up to tonight and their rewards handed out. We invite you to be with us in the morning, 9:15, for the start of Sabbath school. We have divine hour and Bible class, and we know we will be blessed when the children from our very own Desktop Bennett Basic School do our AY program. It promises to be another Sabbath of much blessings, another Sabbath where God's Spirit will be with us and the angels, and we all worship together. At this time, I invite you to tune your hearts and set your minds heavenward as we listen to our theme, the meditation song.
Change my heart, oh God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God. May I be like you. Change my heart, oh God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God. May I be like you. Change my heart, oh God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God. May I be like you.
Presenter this evening is Sister June Hamilton, a well-known and well-loved teacher of our church. I invite you to sit back, not too relaxed, as we listen to her as she presents on the topic, meaning of communion. Sister Hamilton, I turn over to you.
Thank you, Sister Watson. Happy Sabbath, everyone. Now, this evening, we're supposed to be looking at the meaning of communion. And before I start, I'm going to ask my little friends, age range 6 to 17, what comes to mind when you hear the word communion? Just write it in the chat. Age 6 to 17, what comes to mind when you hear the word communion? I see foot washing. All right. Now, I carried out a little survey asking some adults. And the question was, what pops into your head when you hear the word communion? What pops into your head when you hear the word communion? And this was the response. 17 persons said the Lord's Supper. I asked 25 persons. Adventists and non-Adventists. 4 persons said fellowship. 2 persons, communication. 1 person, sacrifice. Another, one accord. This tells me that communion has different meaning to different people. Now, communion has a twofold meaning. The first communion is God's communication to us, coupled with our response to Him. God's communication to us, coupled with our response to Him. Communion is togetherness, fellowship, harmony, sharing, coming into a deep relationship with God. And the other was communion, otherwise called the Holy Sacrament or the Lord's Supper, is a solemn celebration where wrongs would have been made right, sins forgiven, and faith reaffirmed. Now, for our little discourse this afternoon, we're going to look at communion as having an intimate fellowship with God, how he communes with man and man to God, and then we'll look at the meaning of the emblems of the holy ordinances. Now, communication with man or communion started in the Garden of Eden. Communion with God is a deep need for every human being, whether we acknowledge the need or not. This is how we were made to function. And it is ultimately about developing a loving relationship with our Creator. After the creation of the earth, God said that it was good. So he established the Sabbath, whereby he could have face-to-face communion with Adam and Eve. They shared fellowship with nature as they strolled in the garden. They enjoyed companionship with God and holy angels, where love and peace reigned. Their activity was joyful, the garden was beautiful, and everything was pleasing to the eye. They were allowed to eat from any tree except the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Unfortunately, man sinned and shattered their fellowship and the face-to-face communion that they had with their Creator. Man failed the test of obedience and their love for God, and thus they had to be separated. Sinful man cannot look in the face of a sinless God, lest man be consumed. Although man could no longer converse or fellowship with God face to face, God did not treat them as they deserve. He gave the gift of his Son, who came to earth to show us how we can be restored into intimate relationship with the triune God. Christ took on humanity, and sinless though he was, he constantly engaged his Father in communion. He went into a solitary place to talk to his Father and gain added strength. When the burden of our sins pressured him, he asked God if it were possible, let the cup pass from him. God still communes with man today. He communes with us through nature. He communes with us through the Bible. God communes with us audibly. God communes with us through dreams. And I'm sure you can think of other ways in which God communes with us. Prophets, humans. But we also talk to God. We commune with God through prayer, service to others, and being a servant. Now, Steps to Christ tells us that the listening ear can hear and understand the communication of God through nature. Now, when we look about on all the beautiful things around us, and remember, sin had tainted somehow God's creation. But yet we still see beautiful things around us. The mountains, the handiwork, the sea, the sky, birds, flowers. When we see those things, we have to say, God is awesome. We have to say, what a mighty God we serve. Now God spoke to Moses through the burning bush. He spoke to Job through the whirlwind. And I'm sure if we take our place in nature and walk around, the things we see, God can speak to us some truths by what we view. Romans 1:20 tells us, for since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that people are without excuse. So this tells me that when we view things in nature, we know that there is a supreme being. Those things did not come by themselves. Man did not create them. And so we have no excuse to say we have not seen God. God converses with us through his word. Our communication with Christ must be grounded in the study of the word. As God's representative, we must study the word and meditate on them, for therein we will find truths about our God and what it means to be in relationship with him. There's much in our lives these days that distract and prevent us from experiencing genuine communion with God. We are living in a fast-paced world with endless demands. Social media seems to control some of us. It's the last thing before we go to sleep and the first thing when we awake. Our spiritual growth is dependent on our communion with God. And this is only possible if we cultivate a consistent prayer life. We commune with God through our prayers. As a result of this, we must be consistent and persistent. We must humble ourselves, be sincere, admit our unworthiness, and invite the Holy Spirit to take full control. Now, I'm sure you can recall the story of Jacob, the deceiver, how he wrestled with the angel. When the struggle started, Jacob had no idea that it was an angel. But when Satan brought up his sin before him, he remembered the promises of God and claimed them. He wept, he showed deep sorrow. He was broken and he would not let go until he had the assurance that he was forgiven. So he held on. And he said, bless me. Isaiah 12:4 tells us, he struggled with the angel and prevailed. He wept and begged for favor. He found God at Bethel, and there he spoke with him. We too have to agonize and wrestle with God at times. If we are to experience true communion with God, when we pray, we must feel our need for help. Our hearts must be open to the Spirit's influence. We must have a spirit of love and forgiveness. We must exercise faith. We can't pray and don't believe in what we're praying for. Mark 11:24 tells us that whatsoever we desire, when we pray, believe that we receive them. We cannot seek forgiveness when we are not willing to forgive others. Prayer does not bring God down to us, but it takes us up to God. Now, it's all good and well to have family and public prayer, but we're admonished in Steps to Christ, page 98, paragraph 2, that we must go in solitude and bear our souls to God, who hears secret prayers. God communes with us audibly. And I'm going to ask my youngsters, what do they think audibly means? It means that we hear a voice. We hear God speaking to us, literally speaking to us. I'm going to share an experience with you I had a few weeks ago. I came to a crossroads. And when I came to the crossroad, the voice clearly said, "Don't go straight." I looked straight ahead and the road was clear. And I said to myself, the road is clear. So I disobeyed the voice and I proceeded. And when I came to a point on the road, I saw a bike coming head on. I had two options: run him over or stop. I chose to stop. The man jumped off the bike, rushing towards my door. And I heard a voice say, "Open the door." And I opened, stepped out of the vehicle, and whatever happened, the man turned back, went back to the bike. And I said, "This is the voice of God." So God speaks to us audibly. I disobeyed, but God still came through for me. God speaks to us through dreams. He spoke to Samuel. The question is, are we listening when God speaks? Our communion with Christ must be demonstrated through our love and service for others. A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another just as I have loved you. You also are to love one another. By this, all people will know that you are my disciples, if you have love one for another. John 13, 34 to 35. Jesus is our example. And if he is our example, we must seek opportunities to care for the needy and vulnerable. Because as God love moves through us to others, we ourselves grow in love for him. If we say we love God and hate our brothers, we are liars. 1 John 4, verse 20. Now, if Jesus is our example, we must become servants. The final act before Christ was crucified was a profound lesson of humility. It was customary at a feast for a servant to wash the feet of the guest. It was the Passover. The necessary preparations were made, but there was no servant present. Jesus sat with the disciples, but they were determined not to act the part of the servant. They believed that this was below their dignity. Jesus laid his coat aside, girded himself with a towel, poured water in a basin to wash the feet of the disciples. Look at the picture I have on the screen. This is Peter looking at Jesus. And you can see annoyance in Peter's face. And to use the Jamaican vernacular, big man, you can't do this. Oh, the master must wash our feet. Mm-mm, can't work. Jesus rebuked Peter, telling him, if I can't wash your feet, you will have no lot or part with me. My friend Peter asked that his whole body be washed, not just his feet. Jesus washed the feet of his disciples, demonstrating that he was a servant and that he came to serve. We too must become servants if we are to be restored. Having washed the disciples' feet, Jesus said, I have given you an example that you should do as I have done to you. This was not a practice of hospitality like they did in Palestine where they washed the feet of guests. It was a teaching moment of humility and service. Thus, foot washing became the ordinance of humility. This precedes the Lord's Supper. It is an ordinance of cleansing of the heart, not just of the feet. It's a time where we supposed to have self-examination, confession of sins, reconciling differences with our neighbors, our friends, our colleagues, putting aside pride and striving for supremacy. All this must be done before we wash our feet and prepare ourselves for the Lord's Supper. Now, if it is a service of humility, it tells me that I must not be selective in whose feet I wash. I want to wash my friend's feet because our pedicure was well done. Jesus didn't think about the condition, the disciples' feet were in. He humbled himself and washed their feet. The Lord's Supper. The Lord's Supper was designed to keep us, the Lord's Supper was designed to keep before us the sacrifice Jesus made for each of us by dying on the cross. It was designed to commemorate the crucifixion. It was designed to point us to the second coming of Jesus. Now, the Holy Communion, as it says, it's holy. And so whatever is done ought to be holy. For whenever we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Now, the bread represented the broken body of Jesus. and it was unleavened bread, meaning that nothing was added to it. No baking powder, no baking soda. Today, our head deaconess would tell you that they use refined wheat flour, olive oil, and vegetable shortening to make the bread. Why was it unleavened bread? It was unleavened bread because Jesus had no blemish. It was unfermented wine that represented his spilt blood. Jesus without blemish was the only one that could have died in our stead. Now, as a church, we practice open communion. Open communion is when all who have committed their life to Christ can participate. And it doesn't matter if you're from the Catholic Church, the Methodist Church, it doesn't matter which church you're from. You can participate. Now, Jesus' blood also ratified the new covenant whereby we can become heirs and joint heirs with him. Now, if we are to be restored and make it to the heavenly kingdom, we must come into full harmony and communion with the Father and the Son. Let us open up ourselves to the Holy Spirit. Ask him to create in us clean hearts and prepare us for the return of Christ. As we prepare ourselves for the upcoming communion, let us reflect. Is my life in harmony with Christ? Sister White tells us that no one should withdraw themselves from the communion table because they think that others are sinners, have hope and sinned. Let me remind you tonight that when Jesus sat with the disciples and broke bread, guess who was there? Judas. And he also participated. May the Lord help us that as we prepare for his return, we will truly ask him to be on our lips, in our hearts. And as we commune with him, we must remember that the greatest victories are not those gained by talent, education, wealth, or the favor of men. They are gained in the audience chamber with God when earnest, agonizing faith lays hold upon the mighty arm of power. We have an awesome God with power. We just need to tap into the source. May God help us.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you very much, Auntie Junie. And with this in mind, I'm going to be asking our host to play the song for us as we meditate, as we reflect upon the words, upon the reminders just given in Sister Hamilton's presentation. And at the end of that song, worship, we're going to be inviting all the families here on this platform, in this meeting, to pray together. That's our prayer for this evening. Immediately after the song, the family. So whether you are a family of three or four, or you're a family of one, you are family. And we're going to be doing this individual prayer. After we have had the prayer and we get back together, we will ask Auntie Julie just to respond to the one question we saw in the chat, which may be pertinent for a few of our younger children may not understand the meaning of the word. So we will answer that question after the prayer. Sister Host, could you please play our song as we go into our prayer session?
Thank you. hands are torn.
Amen. 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 We thank you for listening so attentively this evening. And at this time, I'm going to ask Auntie Judy if she would be so kind as to give the answer to that question that was posted in the chat. What is the meaning of unleavened?
Okay. Now, when we make dumplings at home, we want them to be soft and nice. So we had some raising agent, whether it is what powder name, baking powder or baking soda, whichever raising agent. Now, unleavened bread has no raising agent at all, none whatsoever. That was why I pointed out that when they prepare the bread for communion, they use the refined wheat flour, olive oil, and vegetable shortening. So unleavened bread has no raising agent.
Thank you, Auntie. That's why it is so flat, right?
And it is not as soft as your dumplings at home when you put the baking soda in it, baking powder.
All right. Thank you so much, Auntie, your presentation. And I'm sure we all were reminded of the importance of the meaning of the communion service. And as we go
say something, Terrian? Point out something, that after the bread or the wine is served at the communion table, if there is left over, it has to be destroyed. It is burnt. The bread, nobody else can eat it. It is holy, so it has to be treated with respect.
Thank you very much for that very important point, because maybe some persons, especially the younger ones, may be wondering, look how much going back around the back, I wonder what they're going to do with it. So now you know, you can tell others who may have the same question, inform them that whatever is left over is destroyed. We thank you for sharing this evening in our family worship. We hope that the blessings of the Sabbath will be yours, not just for yourselves, but to share with others. And that in the end, when Jesus comes with that great communion table, we will all be able to join in. We'll all be able to sing praises to him, give honor and glory to him, and worship together. Thank you for joining us this evening as we play our meditation song. I pray that your family, my family, all families will be blessed. I will have a blessed Sabbath. We see you all for church, 9:15 in the morning, for our Sabbath school, and at our divine hour, our own Pastor Beckford will be with us. And for the AY section, or segment, AY segment, we will be having a children from the Desto Bennett Early Childhood Center. That's our children, our church school. They will be doing the AY program for us. And remember that after the program, we will be announcing all the winners for the week and for last night and tonight. So family, happy Sabbath and stay blessed.
Be like you.
Change my heart, oh God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God. May I be like you.
Sabbath, and we see you at 9:15 tomorrow for church. Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath, everyone.
Happy Sabbath, everyone.
Happy Sabbath, family.
Night, everyone. Night, Delon.
Night, Ashim and Delon. Night, happy Sabbath, Auntie Janet.